Wow. I didn't pay him for that. I did bring pizza, though, Billy, so if you're hungry, amen. Good morning, Christian Life Center. Wow. I am humbled. I am honored and truly excited to be here today, and especially on this platform. It has been an amazing journey to come to this very day for my life. If I could explain to you where I have been, some of the places, some of the things, a prison cell, a prison chapel, 20 years of addiction, to be at this place today, it's truly amazing. Somebody say amazing. So my name is Bob Sofronski. I'm Executive Director of Christian Life Prison and Recovery Ministries. That ministry actually started here at Christian Life Center in 2004 under the care of Pastor David Costin. Thank you for David Costin just believing in a group of people that had this vision to go help people inside of an institution that they were held by bondage and chains of addiction and crime. He allowed us to start that ministry here at Christian Life Center, and now that has moved on to a four-pronged ministry, which consists of prison and recovery, the local coffee house that we have across at the Edge Building once a month, and now Music Fest, which is our benefit to help those in addiction. I've been serving God since 1999, after being incarcerated in 1997, a 20-year history of crime and drug abuse, criminal activity. God reached into the brokenness of my heart in a prison chapel in October of 1997. He changed my life forever. See, I've been drug-free since. I'm 19 years clean this week from my drug addiction. Hallelujah! But listen, it all started when I surrendered my heart to Jesus. That's when it all started, in a prison chapel. So praise God, it is an absolute miracle for me to be on this platform today. I am so glad that I didn't look back and see how many people were here, because that would have freaked me out. I just kept, right, see that cross? That's what it's all about anyway. Amen? But I'd like to share, before we get started into the text today, and maybe I'll share some of that pizza with you in a little bit. I want to share my life verse, because it's an important verse. It's my verse today. Please let me have it for a moment. Amen? Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. They are plans to prosper you and not to harm you. They are plans to give you a future and a hope. See, there's not just hope for Bob Sofronski today. There is hope at CLC here today. Amen? And his name is Jesus Christ. He is the hope of glory. Amen? There is hope for the addict. There is hope for sobriety. There is hope for those in prison, and there's a plan to stay out. There is hope for broken relationships, and there's a plan for restoration. There is hope for the brokenhearted, disease and sickness, and there is a plan for healing. And for those on the outside looking in, it's time to come home to Jesus. Amen. The definition of hope is to expect something, a confident desire that something good is about to happen. I believe the moment that I got saved in a prison chapel in October of 1997, God had a plan for my life. That plan was to be a missionary right here in our region, in our community, to help those who were struggling with addiction. That mission he had sent me on was to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to those held captive, to help set them free from addiction, oppression, to comfort the brokenhearted, the suicidal, to bring hope in what seems to be a hopeless situation, especially for the families of those who are in addiction. Amen? They're struggling. They don't know where to go. They don't know where to go. And that is what the ministry of CLPRM is really all about. Our volunteers are here today. There's a table set up. Raise your hand if you're a volunteer in the ministry of CLPRM. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. See, these men and women that are in the prison and in recovery, they're coming back to our communities. So CLPRM is here to equip them with the necessary and skills needed to become productive members of their families and their communities, to bring and build integrity, to help give them a biblical understanding of God's word and God's will for their lives. Simply, CLPRM is helping to stop the cycle of crime, violence, and addiction by teaching biblical core values in a hostile environment. Friends, there's hope for all those in difficult circumstances, not just for those in prison and recovery, but for everyone here at CLC today. Jeremiah 29:11 says, there is a plan, there is a hope, and there is a future. Someone say, there is always hope. There's information about our ministry out at the table in the foyer today. If there's anything this ministry can do to help you with, we would be honored to be able to help you in any situation that you would have. 2 Kings chapter 4 is going to be the text today. If you want to turn your Bibles or turn your Bibles on, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1 through 6. I want to read through it. I'm going to pray. And I'm going to tell you about a man who I really, really admire. 2 Kings chapter 4. Title of the message today is God is looking for a vessel. He's looking for people in this church today to step up and be used by God. Amen? And there's somebody here today who is maybe teetering on that and wondering, well, how can God use me? How can I get involved here at CLC? Being a part of maybe small groups or maybe a prison or recovery ministry or maybe checking out Road to Recovery or volunteering at Music Fest or being on the leadership team of the church and being on a prayer team. God is looking for a vessel. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1. A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord, and the creditor is coming to take my sons to be slaves. So Elisha said to her, what shall I do for you? I want you to pay attention to that. What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in your house? And she said, your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil. Then he said, go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you and your sons. Then pour it into all the vessels and set aside the full ones. So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. Verse 6, now it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said to her son, bring me another vessel. And he said to her, there is not another vessel, so the oil ceased. Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for this wonderful, wonderful church. Thank you for this opportunity that you and them have given me in this ministry today to be a part of this service. I just pray for a blessing of the reading of your word and the anointing of your Holy Spirit in this room today, that you would seek out those, Lord, that you are looking for and searching for today. Let them respond to the gospel message of Jesus Christ, the saving message of the gospel. Father, we love you and we honor you, and we pray that you're glorified through all this, and we ask that in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen? Amen. We have all heard the familiar passage teaching about this text. Some of us are familiar. It's the teaching of the provision, the never-ending flow of oil that really provided for the widow had lost her husband so that they were able to pay the bills. And that is a great, great familiar text, and what we think of that text being the provision of God. But I'm here to tell you today that God is looking for a vessel. And that's what I really want to focus on today. But I want to tell you a little bit about Elisha. See, Elisha was the successor of the prophet Elijah. His name means God is salvation. He witnessed many of the events in Elijah's life, and he's probably heard the stories from him also of the very power of God. Elisha shows up in 1 Kings chapter 19. He had spent 7 or 8 years as Elijah's protege before Elijah was taken up to heaven in a whirlwind and chariots of fire in 2 Kings chapter 2. before that happened, Elisha asked for a double portion of the spirit that Elijah had on him. How many want a double portion in this house today? To do, listen, not just to do God's work and get out into the kingdom and change people's lives and help people in addiction and in prison chapels, but we need that in our homes, amen? We need that with our kids. Some of our kids are out of their mind. And we're going to need a double portion to be able to handle that. So we get a chance to see about 55 or 60 years of Elisha's ministry through 1 and 2 Kings. A lot of Elisha's miracles really resembled the miracles of Christ. The healing of the waters, the bringing the Shunammite's son back to life, the healing of Naaman's leprosy, the multiplying of the 20 barley loaves that fed over 100 men. So he is called the man of God in the scripture. And I want you to get this. The term man of God is used 70 times in the Old Testament. 22 times it references Elisha. Did you know that? 22 times he's called the man of God. More than anyone else in the Old Testament. Moses was the first one to be called a man of God. A man of God has this uplink to heaven that some other men do not have. There is a special anointing on this man's life to be able to perform these miracles. So 2 Kings chapter 4 takes place about 560 or 538 BC between that time. And here is this man of God that the woman is crying out to. Verse 1, a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophet cried out to Elisha, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord, and a creditor is coming to take my sons to be slaved. What we see in the text is Elisha knew who this man was. This man was a God-fearing man. The woman's husband who had died, it was someone that may have even been involved at some point or close to Elisha in his ministry. But now he has passed away and there needed to be provision. So she was crying out to this prophet, this man of God, how am I going to supply for my kids? And the creditor who we owe this money to, so if you go back into Leviticus and read the law, there was a law that stated that they could come take your children to be slaves until the year of Jubilee if there was debt that was owed. So there was a debt obviously here to be paid, and she was worried that the creditor was coming to take her sons. See, the world wants to come and enslave this generation. They want to enslave them, and they want to addict them to the things of this world. And if we don't stop them, they will chain them, they will bind them, and they will keep them. We have far too many kids in our community, and I know if I sat with every one of you, one out of three people knows somebody that's in addiction or struggling with a family member. One out of three in this congregation today. We have to put it to a stop. I want you to remember something. The oil that is represented in this scripture represents the supernatural anointing of God. It represents the Holy Spirit, the very miracle power of God. How many are looking for a miracle today? How many are looking for something supernatural to happen in their lives? Something they've been waiting for, right? Maybe it is an addicted son or daughter or spouse, or maybe it's somebody in prison that needs to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because no matter what we do as a ministry, it's about that cross right there. It's about Jesus Christ. It's about the blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary that'll free them from their struggle. So remember that the oil represents the supernatural power of God. See, it's not always about ministries and meetings and organizations or even churches or programs. It will take the powerful, anointing, miracle working of the Holy Spirit of God to get the job done. Do you understand that? It's going to take it, because we can kind of go through this process of church life and showing up on Sunday and, well, how come things aren't working and how come things don't look too well right now? Are we really relying on God? Are we relying on the supernatural power of God that's available to everybody in this church today? Everyone. No one is excluded. Verse 2. So Elisha said to her, "What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house?" And she said, "Your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil." Is God asking you today, what do you want him to do for you? What is it that you've been asking God for? And here's a better question. What's in your house? Is it something that can be used for the kingdom of God? What's in your heart? What is really right here? Because this is where he started, right? Long time ago. Like, you remember when you got saved, right? For me, as a prison chapel, it was messed up. I was a 20-year addict in Philly. I didn't know how to do that. I never heard about Christ. I never heard the gospel of Jesus. So I went to a prison chapel. And that day changed my life forever, for eternity. What's in your heart? See, she had all she needed. It was already in the house. The oil was already there. Verse 3. Then he said, "Go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few." See, when we, the ministry, if we look back, and Royce, you know, we laugh about it all the time. We're a bunch of knuckleheads, man. We really are. We're wondering still how to do, you know, all of this, let alone get out there on the field on September 10th and put on a music fest for, you know, 1,500 people. We don't know how to do that, but I know God does. And if we look back on the ministry and how it started in 2004, and how it has grown, and all the volunteers and the people that were helping, there are people right here in this church that their kids are away because of the volunteers in this ministry's effort to get them to a place of safety and sobriety. Amen. That's right. See, God is looking for a vessel. So CLC is searching for this vessel, right, to lead this church. But they're not looking for any vessel. They're looking for a clean and empty vessel. They're looking for someone who's able to hold the supernatural power of God, the anointing, the oil that's represented here. They want somebody to be able to supernaturally help this church by the power of the Holy Spirit. Right away, we're thinking, well, that excludes me. I'm not clean. I'm not empty. And that's how we think sometimes when we wonder, how can God use us? And we're still a little dirty, and we still have got this sin hanging on. We've got so much baggage from the past. But I'm here to tell you, that is one of the benefits of being saved and coming to Jesus, that he cleans it up. See, the blood of Jesus, the word of God, cleans us up so that we can be used. And you can take a look at the CLPRM volunteers or the staff of this church, and we are broken, fractured sinners saved by grace, and only Jesus Christ can fix that. Amen? Only Jesus can fix that. Nobody else. We can't go to our wives and sit in a home Bible study and hope that this thing's going to happen. And no, you got to get with Jesus. You got to get personal with him. Cry out to him and ask him for a supernatural touch, because that's what's going to change your situation. There's a story of this old man in the foothills of Tennessee. He had a young grandson, and each morning, Grandpa would come down and he would read his worn-out Bible. His grandson wanted to be just like him. He wanted to imitate him in any way possible. And one day the grandson asked, "Papa, I try to read the Bible just like you. I don't understand it. And what I do understand, I forget as soon as I close the book." That's probably the norm for most of us, right? What good does reading the Bible do? So the grandfather quietly turned from putting coal in a stove, and he said, take this basket down to the river, the coal basket. He said, fill it up with water and bring it back to me. The boy did as he was told, but the water leaked out before he could even get home. So the grandfather laughed, and he said, you'll have to move a little faster next time. Sent him back to the river to try again. This time the boy ran faster. The basket, of course, was empty when he came back. Out of breath, he said, it is impossible to carry water in a basket. I'm going to get a bucket. And his grandfather said, I don't want a bucket of water. I want a basket of water. At that point, the boy knew it was impossible, but he wanted to show his grandfather. So he went down to the river, came back, gave it all he had. The basket was empty again. Out of breath, he said, see, Papa, it's useless. And the old man said, so you think it's useless? Look at the basket. And for the first time, instead of this dirty old coal basket, it was clean and it was empty. Son, that's what happens when you read the Bible. You might not understand or remember everything, but when you read it, it will change you from the inside out. And that is the work of God in our lives, to change us from the inside out. He slowly transforms us into the very image of his son. That's what the word of God does. That's what the anointing of the Holy Spirit does. Verse 4 and 5. And when you have come in and shut the door behind you and your sons, then pour it all into those vessels and set aside the full ones. So she went from him, shut the door behind her and her sons who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. Sometimes we've just got to shut the door behind us. When God gives us a miracle, when he gives us something that he has supplied, he wants us to go in and shut the door. Matthew 6:6 says to go into your room and pray to the Father and do what? Shut the door. He wants you to do that in secret with the Father, and he'll reward you for that. But sometimes we've got to shut the door. See, the miracle work of the Holy Spirit and the oil will take separation from the things of this world. Close the door on what is not good in your life and see what God will do. Amen? See what God will do. Glory is his name, right? That was my cue. We know that God doesn't always call the qualified, right? He does qualify the called sometimes. And I do feel unqualified and inadequate to share the gospel of Jesus Christ anywhere, whether it's a prison chapel, a church, a recovery meeting, or even with my family. But you know what? There was a day when I shut the door on my life. I shut the door on addiction, and I shut the door on crime, and I shut the door on this attitude I had from Philadelphia that led me into all these things. I shut the door on my past life, and I let Jesus Christ come in and cleanse me and clean me and free me up. Amen. Empty me out. Because he wanted to use me. See, someone said to me after an event we just had recently, she came up to me and she's known us for a while in the ministry. She said, you're not who you used to be. And I really didn't know what that meant because I've been a Christian since 1997 and I've known her for probably the past 10 years. But as a believer, she said, you don't look like you used to look. You look different. See, God could even change what we look like. Matter of fact, he can change your name and he can change your address to a place called heaven. Amen? Verse 6. Now it came to pass when the vessels were full that she said to her son, bring me another vessel. And he said to her, there is not another vessel, so the oil ceased. See, the oil would have kept flowing, and it will keep flowing in this church as long as there are available vessels. Amen? CLC needs your help to be clean, to be empty, and to be ready filled with the supernatural anointing of the Holy Spirit, the oil. See, the limit of the supply of oil had nothing to do with the supplier. He has more than enough. He always does, amen? He's ready to fill those who want to be filled. As long as there are vessels here at CLC, the supernatural anointing of the Spirit will keep on flowing right here in this church. You know the smell of pizza, right? You're feeling it already, right? See, I knew I would get your attention. I already got your attention when I just came up in the beginning and I set this pizza. You're thinking, oh, man, honey, can we go get pizza? I want to go get all the kids are going, Mommy, I want pizza. Mommy, I want pizza. He's got a pizza box, right? Well, this is Dominic's pizza. So, Dominic, you can send a check here to Christian Life Center, 3100 Galloway Road, Bensalem, Pennsylvania. Dominic's is one of my favorite pizzas. But you know the smell. You know what's in the box, and you're getting ready to really chow down, right? When it's your best pizza, because there's some bad pizza out there, right? But when you know it's good pizza, you're ready for it. But imagine if the delivery guy comes to your door and he brings a pizza. You ordered everything. You've got everything on that pizza. He shows up at the door. You open up. He said, did you order a pizza? And he's got it in his hand. Cheese oozing down. Mushrooms falling off. Pepperoni sliding off the cheese. Did you order a pizza? Well, yeah, we ordered a pizza. What is your first question? Where's the box? Because the pizza usually comes in a box. See, I was expecting the product to come in a vessel. The box is only worth 50 cents, but it takes on significant value when the pizza is placed in it. 2 Corinthians 4:7 says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels. It's God's power, not ours. The box doesn't give value to the pizza. It's the pizza that gives value to the box. Are you catching it? We are just a 50-cent vessel. But with Christ in us, we take on this significant value. When he is in the vessel, you don't have to be special and you don't have to be perfect. You've just got to be clean and empty, and he'll be willing to fill you with his supernatural power. Amen. C.S. Lewis said that God gives his gifts where he finds the vessel empty enough to receive them. In Acts chapter 9, we read of God sending Ananias to restore the sight to Saul, who was on Straight Street. Now, we like to use that in recovery because it was on Straight Street, amen? And we're all trying to get straight and sober, so we like to use that. But that same man that Ananias went, see, God said that he would be his chosen vessel. That same man, Saul, became the Apostle Paul, who would become the greatest missionary that ever lived. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 19 and 20 says, our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, if you know Jesus, whom you have been brought with a price. See, John 3:16, we can all quote that verse, and it's some of our favorite portions of Scripture. So God so loved the world, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. See, God sent the vessel. He sent what we needed to restore relationship between man, a sinful man, and a holy God. Satan's already defeated, and we need to know that. Listen, the end game, we win. Did you read the end of the book? We won. So Satan tried to kill the vessel. And what he did was he tore it. and he beat it, and they flogged him, and then they took the crown of thorns, and they put it on his head, and they took him to the hill of Golgotha, and they took him, and they put the spikes right in there, and he did that for you and me. He did that for you, and then they would take him off the cross, and they would lay him in the tomb. But guess what? He didn't stay there. He didn't stay there, beaten, bruised, and battered. And from the cross of Calvary, beaten beyond recognition, he said, "It is finished." He never said, "I'm finished." He said, "It is finished." The work has been done on the cross of Calvary. Jesus holds the keys to life, to freedom and deliverance. Hallelujah. I'm going to close with this scripture, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 20 and 21. I'll give you 3 points and then we're going to pray. "But in the great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay. Some for honor and some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel of honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work." Are we prepared? Where are you in your life today? Is it just a church thing, or have you made it personal yet? Are you willing to be used not just by God in his kingdom, but here at CLC, to get out and get involved in the small groups? And that's why Pastor Billy's here, to encourage you to get involved in the men's ministry, in the women's ministry, in the children's ministry. Here at the church, we need your help, but we also need clean, empty vessels. You say, "Well, that can't be me because I'm full of sin." Well, listen, that's why Jesus comes and cleans us up. And he frees us from those things. He forgives our sin. Cleanses us from all unrighteousness. And God sees his son that was on that cross. Blood dripping down from every part of his body. That same blood is what fell on me and you and cleaned us up one time. 3 points to remember. If we have the band come back up, and if we could get the prayer partners ready for the end of the service. What's in your house? And is it useful for the kingdom of God? Number two. Empty and clean your vessel today, because God is looking for a vessel. God is not just looking for a vessel to lead this church and be the lead pastor. He's looking for people just like you and me that are willing to be a part of the great work, the great plan that he has for Christian Life Center in Bensalem, PA, and Philadelphia and the surrounding areas. But we've got to come to him. Your vessel is now ready, if you're willing to come, to be filled with the supernatural power of God. Revelation 3:20 says that Jesus stands at the door and he knocks. And if you open that door, he will come in and fellowship with you. Here's the problem. Most of the time when we hear that knock on the door, see, he's been knocking for a while. We go to open that door and we go, "Whoa, hold on a second, I'm not ready yet. I'm not ready for that." Honey, Jesus is at the door. And your wife says, "Well, honey, that's what you've been praying for. You've been praying for that. You've been praying for that miracle. We come back to that door and we finally let him in. And we open that door up and Jesus comes in and he resides in this heart. And he begins to change things here personally and in our families and in our homes. For those in addiction, for those in prison, he's able to free them. Amen? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. He said, if you acknowledge me before men, I will acknowledge you before my Father in heaven. Where are you at today? With every head bowed and every eye closed in this sanctuary. Nobody looking around. Let's make it personal. If you feel God tugging on your heart today, and you know he's calling you, you feel that tug of war happen, know that God is reaching out to you. And he wants to save you. He wants you to be born again. Maybe you've never taken that step of faith. Maybe you've got a loved one that's struggling. Intercede for them, but intercede by being filled with the Holy Spirit today, by receiving Jesus as your Savior if you've never had. If there's anybody in this sanctuary today that does not know Jesus, I'm going to ask you to come. We want to pray with you today. We want to pray with you and lead you into the saving relationship of Jesus Christ. Amen? Anybody in this room that needs to know Jesus today, would you lift your hand up if you don't know him? We want to pray with you today. Anybody in this place, anybody in the sanctuary that does not know Jesus Christ, and you've been playing with church, been playing with religion, thank you. Thank you, brother. Anybody else? Thank you. Anybody else? Listen, this is your time. Today is the acceptable day of salvation. It's not tomorrow. What happens when we walk out that door? What if we don't make it home? There is a place called heaven, and that's where God wants you to be. But you've got to know him. Is there anybody else in this room that doesn't know Jesus? We're going to pray with you today. Thank you. Thank you, sister. Anybody else? Anybody else? Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to ask that those that would raise their hand already would make their way up front, meet with a prayer partner. They're going to lead you into this relationship. And here's the second call. It's the call to discipleship. And maybe you're that vessel that's been playing around with this whole church thing and going from ministry to ministry and place to place and not really allowing God to use you effectively. Is that you today? Are you the vessel that God is looking for? Maybe that's you. Would you lift your hand up today if you want to be used by God? Thank you. You want to be used by God today and you're not doing that. Thank you in the back. Thank you in the back. Thank you in the back. Thank you right here. Thank you. Right over here. Thank you. Over here. Oh, beautiful. Hallelujah. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. If you raise your hand, don't deny him. Come, okay? If you've come for salvation, then express that to the prayer partner. If you've come to be used by God, then come. I'm asking you to come. Come if you want to meet with a prayer partner today. For anything that's going on in your life, I want you to come. That's why they're available. And maybe you got a loved one that's sick in addiction right now, and you want to intercede for them. Now's the time. Listen, now's the time. God did not bring me to this platform today. It's about addiction here in this room right now. And if you got a loved one that's struggling, come and intercede for them. And maybe it's you in this church today. Maybe you are in addiction today. And if you would be open and honest today and come and stand with one of these prayer partners, then I promise you, you will never regret the decision that you have made today. Come and be honest with Jesus. If you've been on the outside looking in, come home. Come home to him. You need a special touch from God today. A supernatural touch. You've been waiting for it. Maybe this is the day. you can come and pray with a prayer partner. I'm going to close out in prayer as the band continues to play softly. This is a time of God's anointing up front that you would come and be prayed for. Amen. Let's close out in prayer. Father, we magnify you in a place, and we pray for a special touch over each and every one of these people up front, that you would bring hope and healing back to their hearts, that you would bring them to a place to recognize that you are the Savior of the world, that you are the one that can restore relationships and restore homes and marriages, that you can deliver those from addiction in this place. Bind up the brokenhearted. Release the captive. Set them free today. For those that have come for salvation, Father God, I just pray that their sincerity, that them entering into this relationship with you would be a life-changing event here today at Christian Life Center. Bensalem, PA, August 7th, 2016 will be a day that we can always look back on and remember that God showed up here and he saved my soul. Father, I love you so much. I thank you for a life change. I thank you that you would take me and free me from the very depths of hell and addiction, that you would get a hold of my heart in a prison chapel and tell me that you loved me with an everlasting love, a love that I never knew nothing about, because he loves us so much. I thank you for this church. Pray as we go into this new season that you would supply all that is needed in the pastor, in the staff, in the volunteers, in this congregation. We pray for a special blessing over our families today. As we go out of this church today, let's all remember, Father, that it is the mission field outside that door, and let's tell somebody about Jesus today. So, Father, we love you, we honor you, we pray that you have been glorified through all this, and we ask that in the mighty, matchless name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said amen.